Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning. Marion the librarian here. Galatians 6, 9 through 10. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Matthew 10, 42. And whoever gives one of these little ones only a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple, assuredly, I say to you, he shall by no means lose his reward. Listen to this true story of a small act of kindness I found in a book called Lift Up Your Eyes by Clyde Nichols. By age 36, Margaret Schultz had lost her husband and only child. But instead of focusing on herself and her grief, she trusted her Savior, Jesus Christ, and began to reach out to children who were confined to hospitals. She would always end her visits by saying, "Jesus loves you, and I do too." She found out about a psychiatric hospital, and she went there to see what she could do to help. There was one little girl the staff had deemed incorrigible, and they had locked her up in a cage at the end of the hall. This little girl, Annie, had not spoken in 3 years. Margaret came to see her every day, but there was no sign of recognition. Little Annie just sat silently, staring off into space. For Valentine's Day, Margaret made brownies for all the children, and she took one to little Annie. The brownie was ignored, and Annie continued to stare into space. Margaret left in tears that day. The next day, Margaret noticed the brownie was not there. Little Annie had eaten it. Again, as she did every day, Margaret spoke to little Annie, who just sat and stared. But as Margaret was walking away, she heard a little small voice speak the words, "Thank you." It was a breakthrough. Little Annie got out of the hospital, grew up, and became a teacher. One day, Annie heard there was a little girl who had suffered a severe illness when she was 2 years old. It had left her deaf, blind, and unable to speak. She was totally shut off from the world, and she needed a teacher. So Annie and Sullivan left her home to go help Helen Keller. Isn't that amazing? One woman's willingness to let Christ's love and kindness pour out of her and into the lives of those little children had a ripple effect. Although only this one famous case is documented, I wonder how many others of those little children that Margaret ministered to grew up to accept Christ's love and kindness and then turned around and poured his love and his kindness into someone else's life. Would we? Would we be willing to forget our circumstances and think of Christ's love and tell someone else about his love? To show someone, even strangers, kindness in the name of Jesus? Could we go to a nursing home and drop off some flowers we picked in the fields for some of the residents? Could we make a pan of brownies and drop it off at the fire station with an encouraging Bible verse? Could we go grocery shopping for an elderly homebound person? Could we go to a hospital once a week and rock a baby who was born addicted to cocaine while singing scripture over him or her? Until next time, this is Marion the librarian reminding you to read the living word of God, the
Bible.
That's right, folks. Bye now.
The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Amen.
Okay, it's on. At least constrain you to share the word that God has placed in your heart. Now I want to see if my prayer was effective or not, or whether I was hearing the Lord the wrong way. Does anybody have a word? Okay, two. Here's one back over here, and then I'll get with you.
When God sends you to do something, and you don't have, you don't really have what it takes to go or to take, or the resources to travel that long, and you don't have any of that, and you are there sleeping in the morning, and like around 3 or 4 in the morning, and you open your eyes, you know. Like somebody's telling you, hey, get up. What?
Speak right into the mic.
What is going on? What's going on? And sometimes I think my wife is kind of waking me up, you know. But no, it's God telling me, get up, wake up. And he keeps giving me peace. Because when I go to bed, I'm all, what? We're gonna go to Terlingua, and how are we gonna do it? How are we gonna provide or take or drive or whatever? How are we gonna take all those presents? How are we gonna take all that clothes? And how are we gonna do it? And God always wake me up in the middle of the night and tell me,
amen.
I give you my peace.
Amen.
The peace I got that surpasses all understanding.
Amen.
You receive it when you call for it. I will keep telling my God, I don't know. I keep asking my wife, why are you so in a hurry to get all these clothes together and to make bags and bags and bags? We don't even know what is going to happen. We can tell that We can tell in our own thinking that we're gonna go and we're gonna be okay, but things are not looking that way. Things are not looking like it's gonna happen. But God comes and tells people who is really willing to do it, I provide, I'll be with you. Don't worry,
man.
It's gonna happen. Just keep your faith focusing on me.
Amen.
And I tell you, as the Apostle Paul says, he said, I'm not in need of anything. Of course, he don't have a family, or he don't have children, or he don't have a wife. But he used to say, he'd write it down in the Bible, he says, I don't need nothing. I'm used to be hungry. I learned the technique not to be in despair about the things I don't have. I can't have too much. I can't have a lot, and I don't have not even enough to eat. but I'm happy. And that is something that I always have. If I have a lot, I'm okay. If I don't have enough, I'm okay. And that happened since I was little, since I was in Mexico. It don't matter if I don't have enough to eat one day. It don't matter. Next day will come. And I was not even a Christian. And God was always protecting me. I always tell my wife, God was protecting me even from dying in the places where I was before I was a Christian.
That's right.
When I was before a Christian, he was protecting me.
Yes.
Because he has a plan for me.
Yes.
I didn't know God protecting. I didn't know God protects the ones who are doing wrong in the world. But
right.
if he has a plan for them, he's not gonna let you be harmed or killed or be in a harm's way all the time. When you come to the Lord, it's because he's drawing you to him. He's drawing
right.
you
right.
to him. It's not like you say, one day you say, I want to be a Christian, so tomorrow I'm going to be a Christian. I'm going to decide to be a Christian. No, it's not that way. God is going to draw you to him, to his son, Jesus yeah. Christ. So when someone gives an offering, that's where I want to go. When someone gives an offering to do this missionary thing, to go look for people, and a lot of people is depending on us these days over there. When you or anyone who provides a little gift to go and do it, you never think in your mind and your heart that you do it for us. You're doing it for the Lord.
Amen.
And it's on your own benefit. It's not on the benefit of me. It's not on the benefit of me. It's on the benefit for yourself. So you learn to be a giver for the missions.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember a song some time ago. I don't know what the title of it, but it says, "Thank you for giving to the Lord, not to us, not to me, not for our own benefit, but for your own benefit, because God is going to bless you on whatever you give, whatever small gift you give. He's going to bless you. It's for your own benefit. So we are blessed. People over there get blessed by the small gift that you give out of your heart. Remember what the Bible says, give us according as you have in your heart. Give it that way. Don't give more, don't give less, give according to your heart.
Amen.
I thank you for what you have done for us to do this trip, to go and bless somebody over there. And I'm always telling people over there about this church. I'm always telling them, One day we're going to receive more and more and more and more, that we're going to be able to go more often, if that's the God's will. It's not what we decide, it's what he wants us to do. Amen?
Amen.
I want to pray for the trip. Thank you, Lord, for this great, great pleasure that you gave us to be able to serve you, because you put in our heart to do it. And as you command, we will do. No more, no less. We're not trying it to do for our own benefit, for our own recognition. We don't want to be recognized. We want to be your servants. As you tell us to do, as we're going to do. No more and no less. Because you tell us to do exactly what you tell us to do in your Bible, in your word. Take the word to the ends of the world. Take the word to the ones who have never heard the gospel. And they receive such a great blessing by listening to your word. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do, for what you have done in the past, and thank you for what you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
So we're in Ephesians 5. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. But fornication and all uncleanliness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you, as is fitting for saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know, that no fornicator, unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were once darkness. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them, for it is shameful even to speak to those things, of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. Therefore, he says, awake, you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord, for the husband is head of the wife, as also Christ is head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it. Just as the Lord does the church, for we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this reason a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband.
Thank you. All right, I think most of you
Thank you.
Remember the scripture that we read last week, and let me just say to you, If I get up and say, I have a word for you, and I give a word for you, you mark it down, that is David Miller's word. You'll have to choose whether or not you want to believe that or not. But when God's word says something, you don't have a choice. You may be dumbfounded. You may say, I don't believe that. You may say, I have a formula that shows that it means this and not that. Every word in God's word is true.
That's right.
Everyone. And not only that, it's going to be with us forever.
Amen.
He didn't put down there for us to read for 6 months. It is God's word, period. Last week was God's word. This week is God's word. And I think this completes the other half of what was read last week. God wants us to be in proper perspective with one another. Ladies, there's a word to you. Men, there's a word to us. How do you love your wife? How do you do that? Well, I don't have to tell you. I don't have to explain. You know what you're supposed to do to love your wife. Women, you know what you're supposed to do in order to respect your husband. But that is important. God wants us to do that. And he wants to bless us as we do that. And he won't bless us as we don't do that. That's God's word. God's word is 100% true. Whether you understand it or not, or I understand it or not. I've read the Bible through many times. I'm confessing to you, a lot of that, I don't understand why it's in there. And I've looked in the English. The main tool that I use in studying the Bible is a good English dictionary. And I looked in the English, and I've looked in the Greek, and I've looked in the Hebrew, a little bit of Akkadian. And I would still come back and say, well, that's God's word. I still don't understand it completely yet, but I've got maybe a little better idea. I know that that's God's word. There's no question in my mind about that. God, when you're ready for me to understand it better, I trust that you'll reveal that to me. God wants us to reverence his word. Some of us sometimes don't reverence his word. Sometimes I don't reverence his word by not saying clearly enough, this is God's word. He means every tiny little bit of it in every respect. And he wants us to be careful that we reverence his word and that we do his word. We complete those things that he tells us to do. And sometimes we look at that and we say, oh, there's no way I can do that. I've got too big a problem. I've got too many other obligations. There's things that I need. I promised my friends I'd do something. Forget that. Promise God and then do it. Boy, did we ever hear some testimonies this morning.
Amen.
Does anybody think we heard some testimonies
yes,
this morning?
Yes, absolutely.
They weren't light testimonies. They were testimonies that I was praying on all week and saying, Lord, how are we going to do some of these things? It's up to us to help. Turns out it wasn't. It was up to God. It's never up to us. It's always up to God. He will provide. He'll take care of the needs. He'll bless. He'll create faith in us. So the next time we get another little problem, we know right where to go first. And God will bless us. And God will use us. And God will take that tiny bit of faith that we have and provide the needs that we have. That's all I'm going to preach this morning. Don't fall over. I hope that you will go and think about that a little bit. Pray. You heard some of these needs met that we prayed for. Pray for them. Continue to ask God to show us what it is we're supposed to do. Because there are a lot more things that we're supposed to do. And God intends for us to do those things. Even though we look at that and say, oh, I can't do that. That's impossible. I don't want to do that. It's too uncomfortable. God will meet our needs. God will meet other people's needs. I'm amazed at the little bit that I pray when I look into Scripture. And I see how Jesus prayed and prayed and prayed. The Son of God, the King of glory, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. And he went and prayed and prayed and prayed. And then I look at, Lord, I spent my 7 minutes this morning. That's it. See you tomorrow.
You went for a whole 7 minutes?
Shh. God wants us to be a body. This little body right here. I've heard some people, I wished we had more. Wished we had a bigger church. Wished we had more money. I wish God would trust us a little more and give us some further resources. I don't. I'm so blessed that the God that I know has trusted us with some resources. Now, some of us maybe haven't tapped into those yet. But we heard of some who did this morning tap into those resources and say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for what you've given. We've got a book passing around. I guess, mm-hmm. Sister Rahana, you still have it?
I have it now, I want to read it next.
All right. The reason I gave it to Sister Rahana first was because I knew she would pass it on quickly. Uh-huh. So now it's in your lap. I read this book. As you know, I go around weeping and sobbing all the time. When things happen to me, if I have a panic attack, I want to beat somebody up. I don't wonder what to do. I'm not saying that to put down Kerry or his son. I'm just saying that's how I am. But I read this little book. Took me about 30 minutes to read it, including the times that I was weeping. And I couldn't stop weeping the whole time. My wife would come in and I'd go, hi, honey. How are you doing? Are you all right? No, I'm fine. And she'd go back out and she'd come back in again and there I'd be. I'm sure I fooled her. Did I fool you?
Yeah.
Oh, well, good. this is just one. I want you to read your Bible more. But this little book will challenge you. And the reason it'll challenge you, because it doesn't say go and knock on doors and quote the true gospel to each one that you meet. It says, go and you see someone that's in need, be a friend to them. Meet them, get to know them. You know that takes way too long, do you know that? It takes a long time to know someone. It takes a long time to figure out what their need really is. And then to be able to do something about that.
No.
But that's exactly what this, there's a young girl, I believe she was 27 when she started. Or maybe even younger than that. Sister Rahana, how old was she?
I think you're right, I think she was about 27.
Okay, I got one right. A woman, a young woman, she was made the dean of women at some college, and I don't remember what college that was. Dean of women are usually about 65 or 70 years old when they get to that position. And she wondered, what are people going to think? They're going to think, boy, they blew this one. They made a big mistake putting me down here. But she continued to minister, continued to find people who had problems that seemed impossible, continued to pray for them, continued to see one after the other come to the Lord and know the Lord Jesus Christ, and then go on in their life to do the things that God had created them to be. That's a wonderful book. What's the name of it?
About to Change the World.
Out to Change the World. Boy, that's where we need to get, isn't it? Here's where it begins, right where you're sitting. You can't change this world. Well, you say, well, I wish somebody else would change the world. I wish someone else would witness. I wish someone else would get in a place where people would listen to them. You're it. Look around this little church. This is it. God didn't give us a 10-story building. He didn't give us 20,000 people. This is it. Poor old God, he just didn't know, did he? He didn't know how little we could do. Do we know how much one person can do? I'm talking to you. Right now, most of you don't have enough faith to believe that God could do anything with you, but he can. And he will. And he's going to. But he does want us to trust him. He does want us to talk with him. He does want us to read his word for ourselves. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this good time of fellowship this morning. Bless you, Lord. Bless you for your word. Bless you that it's true. Bless you that we can count on it every single time. Bless you when we come to you and believe in you and trust in you that you will provide for our needs, whatever they are. Take us now this afternoon. Give us a good afternoon. Take us to our home safely. Speak to us. Reveal things to us that we need to know. In Jesus' name, amen. You're dismissed.